This is a psalm of David when he pretended to be insane before Abimelech, who drove him away.
What's the number?
Psalm 34. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him lack nothing. Lions may grow weak and hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, my children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Whoever of you loves life and desires to see many good days, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking lies. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their cries. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. A righteous man may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from all of them. He protects all his bones. Not one of them will be broken. Evil will slay the wicked. The foes of the righteous will be condemned. The Lord redeems his servants. No one will be condemned who takes refuge in him.
Amen.
So if you stand, we are going to start worship.
I'm over. Well, good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good to see everybody today. What a beautiful day, huh? I know it's a holiday, and we have a lot of people that are probably traveling, visiting family. We've got some hunters that are out there. Dave and David Jerry's out there hunting, and Dave's out hunting, and we hope they're successful. And then other people are just gone, but we're here, right? And so we're so grateful for that. I looked out this morning, and yesterday was such a beautiful day, and today is as well. I'm thinking, how fortunate are we? We've got the Sinuslaw Forest out our back door. We get the vast blue Pacific Ocean out the front door. We got blue sky. Our Creator does really good work, doesn't he? Talk about your master craftsman. Yeah. So I have some announcements this morning. You notice I have a little book. I came home and there was a package of these little books on the kitchen table, and my wife had got them for me, and she said, "You might want to make some notes for stuff, you know." I don't know if she's trying to tell me something. You know? Are you saying my steel trap memory isn't working anymore?
Yes.
All right. Communion Sunday is next Sunday. Okay, so be here, don't miss it. We're going to restart the prayer chain. Pastor's going to restart the prayer chain. And if you have requests, you can reach him at tim@lawrenceevangelicalchurch.com or the phone number. And if you have any questions about that, you can go on our website if you have access to a computer. And you have a really nicely done website there. Thank you, Pastor Tim, for upgrading that. He upgraded the website. We're on Instagram and Facebook and Twitter, correct? Yeah, good. So we're there. We're a little soon. Just real quick, I thought this last week that I would check out stuff, you know, just see, look at things. And I pulled up what I thought was the last Sunday sermon. And so it started off, and the ladies were doing a good job of singing up here. And you guys sounded wonderful out there, and you're singing. And then Robin has always said, "No, we're going to have our announcements." And so the camera's right there, and I'm watching the video, and this guy starts coming up the stage. And you can only see him from behind, and he's kind of, my mom would have called him stout, I'd call him dumpy, and you know, head kind of got hanging over his bald head and his hair. And like, do I have the right video? Who is this guy? Who's that dude going up there? You know? And so he gets the microphone, turns around, and it's me. I did not know that I looked like Wilford Brimley. So those of you who don't know who Wilford Brimley is, the blue one when you get home. Okay? So I got a press master. Can you put a filter in the camera that will make me look like Jason Statham? That's what I want to look like, okay? He's tall. Oh, he'll look into it, right? He's polite to say, yeah, Jason Statham is also 40 years younger, 100 pounds lighter, and he has a British accent. But anyway, so, all right, enough of that. Back to the announcements. Sorry for the diversion. Kids Club is going to be starting up soon. Juana's Kids Club, I'm not sure what term we're using for it. But, so more to come on that. And also, Sunday school for the children during church service. That starts today. Okay? So that's good. Cindy's heading that up, and we're putting a call out for volunteers. Like, we can't realistically expect one person to miss every single Sunday sermon to be with the kids. So if we rotate around, everybody gets a shot. So consider volunteering to go down and participate in class or leading the kids in worship. It's very rewarding. And anything else, folks? Okay, that's it. Thank you.
All right, so, hi everybody. I get to step out from these behind the curtain. It's my pleasure today that, you know, there's different, I don't want to say levels because that sounds really weird, but there's just different, I guess, modes of commitment of folks who come to a church. You know, there's the people who are guests, and they're the people where this might be their first Sunday, and this might be their first time even being in a church, and so we welcome them, right? And we want to make this place feel like home, so that then eventually they become kind of like informal family members. They're the people where it's like, oh yeah, that's my home, that's my place, that's the place I go, or, so to speak, that's my church there on the corner of Laurel and Rhododendron, that really hard, long name to say. So, but then, you know, for those who want to take a step further, there's what I like to call like a formal membership, which is a fancy way of just saying you're choosing to make this your family, like commit all the way, you know, taking that formal step beyond just being informal, right? Tracking with me? Okay, so this is my really nervous way of saying, I had somebody approach me on my very first Sunday here saying, hey, I want to become a member. And I'm like, okay, cool. I don't know if I've done this before. So his name's Ron. Ron, you can go ahead and come up. And I got to talk with Ron a little bit and got to hear his story. And I even got to share some coffee with him and our former pastor emeritus, Jack Falls. And so Ron wants to make that step into formal membership. So let's pray. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Christian friends, we rejoice with you that through the grace of God you have been brought to a knowledge of Christ our Lord, and have been made partaker of this great salvation. Ron, we rejoice likewise that you are seeking admission into the church, which is the organized body of believers in Christ. We trust that through this fellowship you may grow in grace and in the knowledge of Jesus Christ our Lord, and that you may become qualified for larger and better service in the interest of his cause. In order that the congregation here assembled may know your purpose and be assured that you are a person to be received into the membership of the Evangelical Church, we ask you to answer the following questions. Do you believe the Bible to be the Word of God, and that therein only is revealed the way of salvation? And do you take this Word to be your rule of faith and conduct? If so, answer that.
I surely do.
Have you received Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord? And do you now confess him? If so, answer, I have received him and do now confess him.
I have received him and I do now confess him.
Do you promise to renounce all ungodliness, to follow Christ, to make diligent use of the means of grace, and sincerely to ask the advancement of the kingdom of God? If so, answer, yes, by the help of God.
Yes, by the help.
Will you faithfully endeavor to know your privilege and responsibility as a Christian and as a member of the Evangelical Church? Will you be loyal to the church and sustain it with your regular attendance and uphold it with your earnest prayer? If so, answer, yes, I will do so.
Yes, I will do so.
Will you contribute of your means to the support of the church as the Lord prospers you? And will you render Christian service according to your ability and opportunity? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Are you acquainted with the doctrine, spiritual, and moral values of the Evangelical Church? Are you in harmony with them, and will you adhere to them? If so, answer, I am, and will do so.
I am, and I will do so.
Awesome. Let's pray. O Lord, as the great head of the church, give to this your servant your heavenly blessing, and grant that he may ever be faithful to you and to your church. Help him to keep the vows which he has made. Enable him, we pray, to grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Fill him with the Holy Spirit. Make him fruitful in every good work. Keep him unto everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we welcome you into the fellowship of the Evangelical Church and of this congregation, And we pray that God may unite us all in the bonds of Christian faith and brotherhood and make us strong and useful in the service. In token of our love and confidence, I now extend to you the right hand of Christian Fellowship. Welcome.
The Lord is my life. The Lord is my life. Thank you. And kids, you get to go to kids' church. How fun!
I'm jealous. I'm going. Pastor can't do that good.
Father in heaven, I'm mindful today of the news from Afghanistan. 50,000 Afghanistans will be coming into America. How many thousands are standing behind the wall near Texas and Mexico? What do we do with these people? They will have no money. They will have no place to live. We are suffering with a homeless problem as it is. I lay this problem in your hands, Lord. And that all the Americans coming home that had been living in Afghanistan will be looking for a place. Please be with each one of them. Each one has a different set of problems. How many of them have been vaccinated? Who will pay their hospital bills? provide for them. There are so many unemployed, so many hurting. Only you can care for them. I pray for a lady named Dee, whose grandson has been thrown out of the home in which he has been living because of the black mold, and he is very, very ill. He has two small children. His wife takes care of them. They have no job, no income. And the little boy is just old enough to go to school. He has no clothes or shoes. What do we do about this? We pray. You know how to provide. I thank you for what you do. I thank you for the beauty in this world. I thank you for bringing our boys home. I pray that they can handle quiet life, or what we call peace. I pray for their families to be able to accept them, so changed from the teenagers that left home. Father in heaven, there is much to be thankful for. We have so much. We don't worry about our next meal. We don't worry about what we will wear. I thank you for the two ladies who have given me their clothes for 40 years. Something always happens. And if we look hard enough, we see that you are right behind it. Thank you for the people who are working to settle these Afghanistans and our Americans coming home from Afghanistan. I pray for all those with COVID and the caregivers, the nurses, the doctors, the people who wash the floor. I pray for those in the hospital that are getting help and those at home whose spouses are working so hard to provide for their families. Give them of your strength, of your courage, of your fortitude. Thank you, Father, for all I have. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father God, I ask for special prayers for the Danowitz family, Mike and Myra, who recently, Mike recently lost his sister. And I ask for traveling mercies for them.
that the staff and the kids who are going to come just put your hedge of protection around our schools. In Jesus' name.
Heavenly Father, come to you before you this morning seeking courage, Father. Courage to talk to you about you to others, Father. I don't have that much, Father. I don't know that I don't worry because I have you, Father. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other is sinking sand. Others take it, understand this, Father. I do not have worries because of you, Father. In Jesus' name I pray.
Lord, I would bring before you our neighbors and our friends and relatives who some know you and some don't. Lord, help us to be your people in the place where we live. And say a word of encouragement to people and to live our lives so that they can see you, not necessarily see us. Lord, we would ask for your increase for the church here. Lord, you know what our needs are here, and you know the resources that we have in place. Lord, we commit those things into your hands. We ask that you help us to be alert to opportunities of sharing the gospel. Maybe in just one word or a couple words. Lord, help us to be sensitive to those people that are not only away from you, they're opposed to you. Lord, help us to be tactful and positive in presenting what you, our great God, has done for every person in this universe, allowing a way for us to become friends with you. So Lord, just help us in this endeavor. I pray these things in Jesus' name.
I just want to lift up thanks to you, Lord, and praise for your protection of my niece and her family, Lord, through Hurricane Ida, and that their house came out intact, Lord, and unscathed. Thank you so much for that, Lord, taking care of them. I will lift up Shelly and her mother, too, Lord, through the grief that they're feeling, their family, that they're feeling the loss of Shelly's stepdad. Just comfort them, Lord, and use us to bring them closer to you, Father. Just thank you for all that you do for us. Praise you, Father. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Father, that you remember our sins no far. As far as the east is from the west. And thank you that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And thank you, Father, that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. And I praise you for that, Father. You are sovereign Lord, and you understand and know and control everything that is going on, even though it appears that the world is out of control, situations are out of control. Keep us steadfast in our faith, Father, and looking to you, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And it's in his name I pray. Amen.
Lord, just as we sing that song, Lord, good, 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 Lord. You are the good shepherd, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for just your mercies and your grace, Lord, every morning, Father. Thank you, Lord, that, Lord, you love us with a love that in our own minds we just can't quite comprehend that type of love, God, that you showed and demonstrated, Lord, for the sinner, God. And Lord, we're just thankful, Father, that Lord, you made a narrow road. And Lord, we know the broad road, your word says, it's big, and many find it, Lord. And you spoke on a day and a year into our lives, Lord, and you saved us from that broad road, and you put us onto a narrow road, Lord, because of your grace and your love and your mercy, Lord, that you demonstrated, Father, to us, God, the sinner. Lord, you made a way when there was no way, God, and we're thankful for that. We want to lift you up this morning, Lord, and just say, Lord, may you have your way in our hearts, in our lives, Lord. It doesn't matter what age we are, Lord. It doesn't matter, Lord, our capabilities, Lord. But, Lord, you use the foolish things, Lord, to confound the wise, God. And I pray, Lord, that this morning, in our hearts, the people you brought to your church, God, Lord, the right people are here this morning, Lord, and I pray that this morning that you would do a fresh work in our hearts, and Lord, maybe it might be encouragement that we need in our hearts this morning, Lord, or maybe we have some fear or some doubt, Lord, or maybe we have a family member, Lord, that haven't made that decision, Lord, for you, Lord. I know. I'm just thinking, as even as my wife prayed, Lord, and my brother, he's 3 miles, Lord, and he's searching. Father, I pray, Lord, as he's laying down, he says he's taking a nap, Lord, in faith, God, that you, the Holy Spirit, would touch his heart, touch the inner being, Lord, of his soul, and wake the darkness, Lord, and may the light reveal, Lord, the truth into him, God. That, Lord, that he would come to that result, to that end, and say, yeah, Jesus is real, and we have to accept him for our sins, that we can get to heaven. Lord, I pray that you would do a work. Your grace would pour into his heart and his life, Lord. Lord, that you would lead him down them roads as he's searching to find the truth, God. Lord, you want all to be saved, you said, Lord. And I pray you do a work in his heart and his life, God. Lord, I pray that you would give us the faith, Lord, and the grace, Lord, in love to approach that neighbor, Lord. Or that person at the store, God. That the Lord, that we would have the love in our hearts as you look upon us, that we would have it towards the lost, God. Lord, and that we would see that people need to hear the good news. They need to hear about Jesus. They need to know that there's a way. Yeah, their dad ain't been a drunk, and their mom a loser. But Lord, you made a way. And I pray, God, that we would see that as we go out into this town,
God, and into the stores and on the streets. That would be on our minds as we're looking upon people. That would be saying, Lord, please open a door. That we could share to people that maybe have never heard about Jesus. Or maybe have, but the seed fell on rocky ground, Lord. Lord, give us that desperateness in our hearts. God, that, Lord, we have the good news. We're the light on the hill, shining into this dark world. And it doesn't matter. It has nothing to do with us, God. But Lord, give us the boldness, Lord, to see that people need to come out of the darkness and into truth and into the light, God. I pray for Tim. I pray for Angie. I pray for their kids. I pray for their house. I pray that you put a hedge of protection around them, God. Lord, we know there's an enemy. Lord, we don't have to go too far from ourselves to know that. Lord, there's an enemy out there that wants to come and seek and to destroy. And I pray that your Holy Spirit, Lord, would be upon them. Lord, and that you would put that protection on them, God. And that, Lord, that you would continue to use them in whatever way that you want to use them for your glory and for your purpose, God. You brought him here to be a pastor of this church, God, and his family, Lord. And I pray that, Lord, that you continue to work into Tim's heart and in his life, Lord. I pray for the children's ministry that you put on their hearts to get going, Lord. And the Bible study over here with Norm, Lord. And the prayer time, Lord, as it gets going here in a couple weeks, Lord. Father, thank you for that, God. And Lord, may you bless it. Lord, may we see fruit come from that ministry, God. Lord, and may the loss come in, Lord, into your church, Lord. So Lord, speak through Tim this morning, Lord. Well, you've been talking to him through the week, Lord. Use his mouth this morning, Lord, to spread the word of God, the thing that changes us, Lord, Father. And may our hearts be right this morning to receive what you want to say to each person in here today, God. So we give this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good
Catholic church, and even though I was on the worship team at my church, I was not playing piano at that time, believe it or not. I was rocking it on the bass and the guitar and the drums on occasion. But I was on this journey to explore this faith that I had been brought up into. And like many seasons in my life, music played an important role as I discovered who God was and what that meant to me. Now, I had grown up to appreciate most bands of the classic rock genre, even the less popular but just as influential hippie bands, from the British Invasion to Laurel Canyon and even Woodstock and beyond. I got a good education that way. But there was one band, not of that era, but a little bit later, that somehow eluded my classic rock music education, and that was the band U2. I don't know how, but it wasn't there. So every so often, I would hear on the radio station in Portland, KGON, this song that every time it came on, I would stop everything, and I would just want to listen to this song. And it set my soul on fire every time I heard it. I never heard another rock song like this in my life. It started with this ethereal organ thing. What's it going to do? I don't know. But here we go. And then the chimes of the electric guitar comes in and starts to create more tension. And then finally the drums and the bass burst into the mix with this driving quarter note beat that makes you feel like you just want to go on a run. And that's very fitting because the very first words of the song are, "I want to run." And so, if you're not familiar with the band U2, the song I'm talking about is called Where the Streets Have No Name. And I eventually got the CD with the song on it, and I would put it in my compact disc portable player in my pocket, and I would listen to it every night while starting my shift at the Valley View Day School. It was really quite an inspiring way, like, I'm going to clean those toilets. I'm going to fill that paper. Here we go. And so it was a great way to start the night. But even though that was the song that introduced me to the band U2 and their album called Joshua Tree, that oddly enough was released the year I was born, the song that I came to love most, and if you look on the Spotify song play count, I listen to Spotify, but the count, it's like millions of plays, but it also happens to be one of my favorite songs. It's called I Still Haven't Found What I'm Looking For. Listen to the words of this song. Bono writes, "I have climbed highest mountains, I've run through the fields only to be with you. I have run, I've crawled, I've scaled these city walls only to be with you. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for. I have kissed honey lips, felt the healing in her fingertips that burned like fire, this burning desire. I have spoke with the tongue of angels. I have held the hand of a devil. It was warm in the night. I was cold as a stone. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for. I believe in the kingdom come. Then all the colors will bleed into one. Bleed into one, but yes, I'm still running. You broke the bonds and you loosed the chains, carried the cross of my shame. You know I believe it, but I still haven't found what I'm looking for." Now, beyond just being an amazing piece of songwriting, I'm always a fan of that. What I love most about this song is that the writer really captures this feeling that he's tried all these things in his own effort to pursue this thing he's looking for, this object of his desire, but through all these efforts, he still hadn't found what he was looking for. And my take on the song, because I know a little bit of the backstory of it, was that Bono was actually all along kind of expressing how he was looking for God through all these things. Kind of like how St. Augustine wrote once, he said, "Everlasting God, in whom we live and move and have our being, you have made us for yourself, so that our hearts are restless until they rest in you. You know, and I think if we're honest, everyone reaches that point sometime in their life. We do all these things, we do all this stuff, we try all these different band-aids to put on the situation to find fulfillment somehow, kind of like filling in the hole on drywall once there's a hole in it. You try your best, but it's still just put it in there. But all along, what we really need is God. And so with that in mind, the title for today's message is What I'm Looking For. If you're taking notes, our passage this morning is Matthew chapter 2. And the big idea that we're going to be exploring today is that Jesus is worth the journey. Jesus is worth the journey. This morning we're continuing in our series where we're taking a look at the gospel according to Matthew in the Bible. It's that first piece of writing in what we call the New Testament. And it's here that we are introduced to the King of God's kingdom, Jesus Christ. Our first week we looked at Jesus' family tree and we talked about how Jesus saves in all our life. Last week we looked at the birth story of Jesus and how the young woman named Mary and her fiancé Joseph handled the news that Mary was pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit, even though she was a virgin. And through this scandalous ordeal, we discover that with Jesus, we experience God's saving presence. And today, we're looking at the journey of some wise men from Persia who took a look for the Jewish Messiah so that they could honor and worship him. So, if you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Matthew chapter 2. Matthew chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. You all are probably already there. I'm the only one left here in the dust. Here we go. Beginning in verse 1. Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of King Herod. About that time, some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking, "Where is the newborn king of the Jews? We saw his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him." King Herod was deeply disturbed when he heard this, as was everyone in Jerusalem. He called a meeting of the leading priests and teachers of religious law and asked, "Where is the Messiah supposed to be born?" "In Bethlehem in Judea," they said, "for this is what the prophet wrote. And you, O Bethlehem in the land of Judah, are not least among the ruling cities of Judah. For a ruler will come from you who will be the shepherd for my people Israel." Then Herod called for a private meeting with the wise men, and he learned from them the time when the star first appeared. Then he told them, "Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. And when you find him, come back and tell me so that I can go and worship him too." After this interview, the wise men went their way, and the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them and stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house and saw the child with his mother, Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasure chests and gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. When it was time to leave, they returned to their own country by another route, for God had warned them in a dream not to return to Herod. That's interesting. Continuing verse 13. After the wise men were gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. "Get up, flee to Egypt with the child and his mother," the angel said. "Stay there until I tell you to return, because Herod is going to search for the child to kill him." That's different than what he had said before. Now, that night, Joseph left for Egypt with the child and Mary, his mother, and they stayed there until Herod's death. This fulfilled what the Lord has spoken through the prophet, "I called my son out of Egypt." Herod was furious when he realized that the wise men had outwitted him. He sent soldiers to kill all the boys in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old and under, based on the wise men's report of the star's first appearance. Herod's brutal action fulfilled what God had spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. A cry was heard in Ramah, weeping in great mourning. Rachel weeps for her children, refusing to be comforted, for they are dead. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt. "Get up," the angel said, "take the child and his mother back to the land of Israel, because those who were trying to kill the child are dead." So Joseph got up and returned to the land of Israel with Jesus and his mother. But when they learned that the new ruler of Judea was Herod's son Archelaus, he was afraid to go there. Then, after being warned in a dream, he left for the region of Galilee. So the family went and lived in a town called Nazareth. This fulfilled what the prophets had said: he will be called a Nazarene. So if you're taking notes, the first thing we find in our passage is the wonder that inspires. The wonder that inspires. In the Bible, there's this idea called revelation. And I'm not just talking about the final book that Norm and his crew are going to be studying in a couple of weeks, even though that's a really wild ride and totally should go for it. No, revelation, in just a really basic way of understanding it, is how God speaks to us. It's like an unfolding. It's like a message that unfolds. Like, you're opening a letter, here you go. And so you get to receive how God speaks to us. There are two primary distinct ways that God speaks to us. The first is called general revelation, and the second is called special revelation. Now, general revelation refers to God speaking to us through things that we all experience. Something anyone, anywhere, anytime can experience. Kind of like natural events or nature in general. We see this in Romans 1, 19 through 20, where the Apostle Paul writes about humanity, saying, "They know the truth about God because he has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and sky. Through everything God made, they can clearly see his invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature. So they have no excuse for not knowing God." We can experience a revelation of God by going down to the beach and watching the waves, or going on a hike, sitting and watching the stars in the night sky. General revelation is something that we can all experience at any time. The difference in special revelation is that when God speaks, it's to specific people at specific moments and places in time. Some examples of this are like how God spoke to Noah and warned him about the flood and said, "Hey, go build this boat." And Noah said, "Okay, how long again?" Or how he talked to Abraham or other people in the scriptures. We see examples of this in how God spoke to the people of Israel through the prophets. And for you and me this morning, the most significant special revelation that we have is the Bible, where God speaks to us through the written words of this book, because the Holy Spirit inspired people like you and me to write down what he had to say. Revelation. Now, here we have the story of these magi who were probably trained in some wisdom tradition that the prophet Daniel led through his time in Babylon. Maybe he left some notes for those future generations of magi. Maybe not. We don't know. But whatever the case, these lost wise men were looking at the stars one day. You know, another night at the office and all, when somebody saw something. And that group of wise men saw this astronomical anomaly of a star that moved them to wonder at this strange occurrence, and they went on to interpret it to mean the announcement of the birth of the Jewish Messiah. I don't know how they got there at the side of the star, but they did. It's not like we have another paragraph in the Bible here to clue us in. But enough to say, they were so convinced of this newborn king in the land of Judah that they got up, gathered all their group together with their gifts and all, and started following this star. The Magi experienced a general revelation from God. Anyone, anytime in the world could have seen on a clear night and witnessed that phenomena take place. The only difference was the wise men were looking. And they were searching for messages from the stars. And they got this message from God loud and clear. Now, here's what's really interesting to me. This is how cool our God is. While I was doing my study this week, I discovered that the wise men's journey was actually foretold by the prophet Isaiah. Want to find out how? Let's go there together. Isaiah chapter 60, verse 6. This is about 750 years before the wise men would have gone on their journey. Check this out. Isaiah 60, verse 6. It says, "Vast caravans of camels will converge on you," talking about Jerusalem. "The camels of Midian and Ephah, the people of Sheba, will bring gold and frankincense and will come worshiping the Lord." How amazing is that? That's pretty cool. Now, the wonder that inspires is witnessing a revelation from God that moves you to act. God was fulfilling a promise he had made to his people to send them a Savior, to be God with us, who would bring about salvation, who would set all things right and establish God's kingdom here on this earth. But some people, most of the people of God at that time, they completely missed it. God was signaling the fulfillment to his people, and they didn't see it coming. Why? I have an idea of what may be the case, maybe kind of like we experienced today. I don't know about you, but sometimes I can be in an impatient person. I know that's hard to believe because you just have met me and you don't know me that well, and maybe you might think I'm a patient person. There are times I'm not so patient. But maybe in our impatience, we stop short of the God-fulfilling promise, and we settle for what we deem possible in our own strength, rather than take the journey to search out where God is wanting to be our fulfillment. We become contented by lesser things, even good things. And what we see here in the wise men's journey is that the world is searching for something real. They're looking for a hope to experience and participate in real, full life, real salvation. More than just a checkbox on a job report, these Magi were committed to coming and experiencing this real newborn King of the Jews and to honor him and worship him. News that God has come to save should inspire us to worship, but like Herod, power and pride keep us from embracing and experiencing the God who has come to renew and restore all things. We see that in the leading administrations of Jerusalem. When the wise men and their entourage, they come to town, Jesus' kingdom was seen as a threat to the status quo. And this news was not received well. Now the wonder of this moment is that God knows the place and the time that his promises are fulfilled. The question is, will we believe and be ready to receive and participate in his good for us? Or will we spin out in our unbelief and ultimately reject what God is doing among us? Has the wonder of Jesus inspired you to make a journey to look for him? Will we go out of our way like the wise men to search him out so that we can experience and worship this king? The good news is that Jesus is worth the journey. In addition to the wonder that inspires, we find in the story the worship that fulfills. For the wise men, they saw the star and they started their journey. God had spoken in a way that they could understand, they could relate to, and they responded with action. 2 years pass, though, since that first sighting, and they end up in Jerusalem, because that's the place you would expect, Jerusalem, capital of Judah and Judea, you'd expect for a newborn king to be born in the capital city. Jerusalem was the easy answer. Because when there's a long stretch between the moment a promise is revealed, and we experience that, to when a promise is fulfilled, it's easy to grow impatient and get off course. Like most people, maybe the wise men saw an easy answer and an easy fulfillment, and they were ready to settle on that rather than resting in what God had said and stay the course. But thankfully, because Herod launched a full-scale, full-line investigation with the priests and scribes who knew the scriptures backwards and forwards, they were able to recite, as a matter of fact, that, well, the Messiah is going to be born in Bethlehem, King David's hometown. So the Magi and their crew received this directive to go to Bethlehem, and they are on the road again. Not only that, but as a result of pressing further, they return ultimately to looking for the original sign as a confirmation. And lo and behold, that star led them to Bethlehem, and the fulfillment of God's promise was guided by what God had spoken, not by their feelings. And the fulfillment was well worth the wait. Verse 10 and 11 said, when they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house and they gave, I'm summarizing now, but they gave Jesus the gifts, and they bowed down and they worshiped him. When God reveals, we respond. And that response is what we call worship. In one of the most humble and common places of life, the wise men encountered firsthand the special revelation of God's one and only Son, Jesus Christ. They recognized God's presence and Jesus' lordship, and that moved them to bow before this child king. Worship is our response to God for who he is and what he's done, because our experience of him confirms his worth above all others. Did you know that King Herod was actually a well-renowned king? I didn't know that until I studied it. King Herod was actually known as Herod the Great. And he built, check this out, a mega temple that far outsized Solomon's temple for the Jews. And he had many great exploits in his life. But the Magi didn't bow before Herod. At least we don't read that in the text. But they didn't bow before him as king. They wanted to worship the newborn king, the Messiah. They bowed before Jesus. And they saw in Jesus the quality of who he was, and what he was going to do as the Jewish Messiah. They discovered through it all that Jesus was worth the journey, and their joy at finding that object of their desire was fulfilling. Much like that quote from St. Augustine earlier, the Magi had found their rest in Jesus. They had found what they were looking for. And this brings me to ask the question, what is significant about those gifts that they carried with them all the way from their home in the east to this humble place in the little town of Bethlehem? Well, I'm glad you asked, and I'm glad I did too. These gifts were fit for a king. The value was beyond great. The gold and frankincense correspond with the verses we read in Isaiah. The gold recognizes Jesus as king. Frankincense was one of those ingredients in the recipe that was given to Moses for the incense that would be burnt so that the high priest could offer up prayers on behalf of the people and in the holy place. And frankincense recognizes Jesus as high priest, kind of like we read last week or the week before and in Hebrews. And the third gift, myrrh, was an element that was also used in the anointing oil to set priests apart for the work of being in the Lord's house and ministering before the Lord. Myrrh is also listed in that recipe in Exodus chapter 30. And myrrh was an element that was also used commonly in Jewish embalming. All together, it speaks to how Jesus, our high priest, was going to offer up the ultimate sacrifice for one time for all to bring salvation to everyone in the world. Myrrh recognizes Jesus as our great sacrifice to bring healing to all humanity. King, priest, and sacrifice. This is who the Magi recognized and believed Jesus to be. This is the Messiah they had come to worship. What about you? Who has Jesus revealed himself to be to you? Have you found in your response to Jesus a fulfillment that comes from him alone? Wherever you're at today, listen to the words of the old hymn, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face and the things of because to really experience Jesus proves to be worth the journey. As we kind of wrap things up, the wise men journey also found the witness that continues. Here we have this climactic moment of revelation and response, and the Magi had seen the fulfillment of their journey and experienced a meeting with the Jewish Messiah, and both they and Joseph were warned in dreams to get out of town. On the other side of having fulfilled their objective, what were the wise men to do? They returned to their own country, and they had the new task of taking what they had experienced in Bethlehem and to share it with their world. And that's really how it works with us, right? When we experience Jesus, we taste and see that God is good. We receive a story that testifies of his goodness. My good friend Stefan calls it our gospel. Taking not just the facts and details about the gospel, which are 100% absolutely true and good to know, but actually that you receive it and experience it for yourself personally, and it impacts you and it changes you and transforms your life and gives you a witness that continues. For the wise men, we don't know their names, and we don't know that much about them from this point on in Jesus' story. But what we do know is that this was an awesome encounter. And I imagine that if I was in their shoes, I probably wouldn't ever be the same again. How would I approach everything in my life? Would that be different, being shaped by that experience and influenced by that moment? I think this may have been the case, because I know for my own self, when I have encountered Jesus in my own life, experiencing his amazing grace firsthand, receiving that scripture from Romans 8:1 that there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, praise the Lord for that. that has shaped and influenced me as a person, experiencing Jesus through the person of the Holy Spirit for myself. And the witness continued for the Magi, and it continues for you and me this morning. God's story shapes our story, and we're trusted to carry the message of our experience of God and His goodness with us as we continue our journey. In Exodus 34, Moses had an encounter of God and His glory, and it's in that great chapter of the Bible that we hear God describe Himself. But in his life, Moses couldn't just live on that mountaintop moment. He couldn't just constantly live at the place of the tent of meeting where he would go to talk to God. Moses had to come down off the mountain and take what he had learned on the mountain into the everyday parts of his life. The nation needed Moses' witness to continue. In the same way, the Magi and Joseph and Mary's witness also needed to continue. God directed them in their way, and they surrendered to His leadership. In the same way, our continued journey of submission to God's plans and purposes confirms our belief that Jesus is worth it. So what is God calling you to do with your experience of Him this morning? I believe the beautiful call of this passage is to allow our experience of Jesus to knit us into the overall tapestry of God's redemption story. You have a story of what God's grace means to you, how His kindness led you to repentance and brought you to the place of full surrender to the Savior King named Jesus. You may have not even known that He was a king at the time, but you just knew that Jesus died for your sins, and you put your faith and trust in that, and how that completely, utterly changed your life. The witness continues because Jesus is worth the journey that we take every day to carry the good news of what we've experienced into every part of our lives. Now, the rest of chapter 2 stands as a sobering look at how Jesus' story is linked with the story of Israel and the story of the Exodus as a sort of literary motif. Here in Matthew's Gospel, we see a pattern that's strikingly similar to Moses' journey. How Moses was God's chosen instrument around the time he was born, Pharaoh threw all the babies into the Nile River that were 2 and under, and ultimately God called Israel out of Egypt. Jesus echoes this, where Jesus, as the Messiah, was God's chosen instrument. Around the time he was born, or 2 years later, within that time frame, King Herod ordered all the Jewish boys to be murdered, and all of that was to quell any threat to the throne. And God sent Joseph and his family to Egypt to protect Jesus, but also so that it could be fulfilled from a prophecy in Hosea that God would call his son out of Egypt. There is no righteous justification for the genocide of this generation of Jewish boys. None. But that being said, I do think that in the record of these events, we find that God knew that this wrong would take place as the Messiah and his kingdom would come on the scene. Because the kingdom of this world is at odds with the kingdom of God. Because God's goodness threatens to undermine and overcome the cheap alternative that keeps us bound up in the world. The good news that Messiah has come is that God has come to rescue us out of our sin and death and deliver us into everlasting life in His kingdom. So as the story wraps up, we find that God provides the way of rescue. And so I don't know about you, but kind of like these wise men that we read about today, what I'm looking for in my experience with God and this journey of faith is a wonder that inspires. Looking for that revelation from God. For God to actually speak today. Did you know God speaks today? He can actually speak to you today. I'm looking for the worship that fulfills, that experience of actually coming into his presence and having that encounter with the living Jesus. The witness that continues, that witness that we carry with us everywhere we go, that we can share the gospel with boldness because God has touched my life and he's touched your life. And we can just share, you know, what that experience meant to us and the way that rescues. And because of all of that, it all points me to Jesus. That's what I'm looking for. And my soul finds rest and fulfillment in him and him alone. Would you pray with me as the worship team comes up? Father, we thank you for this morning, for this Labor Day weekend. We thank you for the opportunity we have to gather together and read your word and sing some songs and pray with one another. And thank you that we have that opportunity. And God, right now, for anyone who is watching, for anybody who is here in the service right now, God, if there's something that we're searching for, that we're trying to fill with other things, I believe we're really searching for you. And so God, help us to overcome our pride and any kind of idea of being ashamed that maybe it took us this long to figure it out. And help us to cry out to you. I also ask God that for those of us who have been walking with you for a long time, I pray that you would reinvigorate our walk. That you would just breathe fresh life into it. That we would come away from moments of hearing you speak just with astounding wonder. That we would worship you and that that would fill our love bucket, so to speak. God, that we would be your witnesses, both here in this little area of Florence, maybe to Mapleton and Swiss Home and all the surrounding areas and beyond, God, that we would be witnesses everywhere we go of the difference you've made in our lives. God, thank you so much that you chose to rescue us and that you love us so much and that we can rest in you. For all my friends here today, as we respond in worship, speaking of your excellencies, God, we want to bless your heart this morning. In your name.
Amen.
Glory. Guys, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Have a wonderful Labor Day. And as you go from this place, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
Amen.
Have a great week.